on the subject of modern writings in Sanskrit, a structural and linguistic analysis. Before I take up the subject, I would like to recount an incident. It was the year 1984. The World Sanskrit Conference was taking place at the University of Pennsylvania, Philadelphia, United States. The conference had certain plenary sessions, some two or three of them, and the general sessions. In the plenary, all the delegates attending the conference were to be present. The topic was modern Sanskrit. I was put in the chair on the dais all by myself, with no table even in front of me, to preside over this plenary. Just as the session was about to start, a scholar from India got up and put the question, "What is modern Sanskrit? If it is following the rules of Panini, if it has the same vocabulary or the same case affixes, the vibhaktis and the prating pratyas, then it is Sanskrit, all right? Then why to make a distinction? Why to draw a line between the two Sanskrits, the ancient Sanskrit and the modern Sanskrit?" I was in the chair, so I normally the procedure is that the chairman offers his comments towards the end of the session or the plenary. Now, I looked around in the hope that somebody from the audience would get up to answer this question. I waited for a couple of minutes. Nobody got up. Then I thought I would better answer the question myself. I started speaking, depending heavily on my memory, because I didn't expect, that I would be called upon to speak on this subject. I would only expect it to offer my comments, and that too towards the close of the plenary. And went on speaking for 35 to 40 minutes. What I spoke there extempore, I put down in black and white later. And it is this which I'm going to present to you today. The modern Sanskrit literature is very vast. Hundreds and hundreds of works have been written since the past two centuries and a part of the present one, in almost all genres except one or two. There have been some pioneering attempts in those exceptions as well, two of them by myself. The reference has just been made to the autobiography that I have written. The two volumes made their appearance in 2013 and 2015 respectively. The third volume, comprising about quarter to 500 pages, is now running to the press. So altogether, the three volumes of my autobiography, titled Bhavitavyanam Dwarani Bhavanti Sarvatra, the line picked up from the Abhijnana Shakuntala of Kalidasa, will see the light of the day next month. So all the three volumes would comprise more than 1,100 pages. So with a vast Sanskrit literature, the modern Sanskrit literature available, it is time now to analyze it from the various points of view. I am assigned the topic of dealing with the modern writings in Sanskrit in their aspects of structural and linguistic. Now, with this, these prefatory remarks, I start. What is being written now by way of Sanskrit is in no way different from the Sanskrit of old. If strict adherence to grammatical rules were to be the sole criterion of determining its character, that is what makes it Sanskrit in its strictest sense of the term. The way of nominal and verbal formations, the primary and secondary forms, the cases and the compounds are all the same. What, however, is not the same is the vocabulary and the mode of expression, including idioms, proverbs, and metaphors and style, which impart a different look to it. With exposure to the West, the entire way of life of the educated upper and lower middle class in India has undergone a sea change in dress, food, and lifestyle. It has come deeply under the Western influence. What was left out by the Western civilization was supplied by science and technology. On Indian roads, no longer ply the bullock carts, the shakatas, or the chariots, the rathas only. Bicycles, cars, buses, tempos, scooters, scooties, motorbikes, and motorcycles are seen racing now even in the remotest parts. The country has now a network of railways, which is one of the most extensive in the world. So has it a fleet of airplanes, from Fokker Friendship to Jumbo Jets, both for internal and external travel. Radios, transistors, and television sets are a common enough sight in Indian households. Even the countryside in some parts. Gramophones are getting obsolete. The cassettes and the stereo system are the in things. Vaidyas and Aushadhalayas are getting sidelines in preference to modern doctors, clinics, and hospitals. Telephone, postal services, and mail now connect all parts of the world. Sofas, tables, and chairs now decorate the drawing rooms. The standing kitchens now have the most modern gadgets. The food and drink habits of the people are fast undergoing change. Toasts, sandwiches, biscuits, and fast food are common enough items for breakfast and tiffin. Tea and coffee among hot beverages are now national drinks. Even the poorest of the poor and the lowliest of the lowly beginning their day with them. Cold drinks of the cola variety are the rage, especially among populations. Of vegetables, potatoes, and tomatoes, both of non-Indian origin, are the most popular. Lunches and dinners are now served on dining tables in chinaware, while drinks are poured in glass tumblers. A Sanskritist to be realist may have to describe all these things, or may have at least to refer to them in the context of the themes relevant to modern life. For works, for them, he may have to depend upon other languages. He may either have to adopt them as such, which means that he may have them as loan words or approximate them in sound and sense to Sanskrit to make them look like Sanskrit, or coin words for them which may carry in them their sense somehow, that is, have them in loan translations. And this is precisely what he has done. The result, modern Sanskrit has come to have a large corpus of new and hitherto non-existent words. For loan words, the Sanskritist has to assign, in keeping with the genius of the language, the gender, which has to be by and large arbitrary. The old Sanskrit stock of indeclinables, particularly the exclamatory ones among them, he may add quite a few, like aha, oh, wah, eh, as current in vernaculars. Many of the idioms and proverbs too he may incorporate in the form of loan translation, which he has done. Similarly, the way of expression in a foreign language, like this is not far from truth, he has incorporated as such, just in literal translation, idam satyan nati dure asti. So as the expression, he fell from grace as sa adara prachito bhavat. Some of new words in Hindi and the other vernaculars, like sambhranta for well-to-do, samaroha for function, pratiyogita for competition, are now common enough occurrence in modern Sanskrit and have both been accepted as part of the Sanskrit vocabulary, though totally non-existent in older Sanskrit, in the senses in which they are used now. The same is the case with a plethora of Sanskrit-based Hindi and other vernacular words to serve as equivalents of English technical terms. Arakshana for reservation, Adikshaka for superintendent, Panjikarana for registration, Swagata Kaksha for reception hall are now freely used in Sanskrit in the necessary case formations. All this cumulatively adds up to the rise of the phenomenon designated the modern Sanskrit. Any discerning critic cannot but notice the wide chasm between old Sanskrit, which after a period came to have a stereotyped character with little inlets for fresh introductions, and the modern one flooded with large inroads, imparting to it a new look, leaving a new impression in its totality on the mind, heralding the dawn of a new era. It stands out as an entity in itself. Old yet new, stereotyped yet progressive, classical yet modern, it is this which is modern Sanskrit. For full appreciation of the modern Sanskrit, it is worthwhile to have reproductions from a cross-section of the modern Sanskrit writings, especially those which deal with modern themes, for it is in them that there is greater opportunity for modern Sanskrit surfacing itself, in that in attempting to depict the modern world as such, through a medium which, as it is, may be inadequate, though the modern Sanskrit writers have to reinforce their works with words and expressions from other media. In vocabulary, modern Sanskrit writers have adopted a threefold approach. Number one, they have either retained the foreign words, particularly those of English, that have crept into modern Indian vernaculars, have acquired a tinge of familiarity. Or number two, they have made them, as also in many cases, words and expressions in vernaculars, look Sanskrit, to avoid in all probability their appearing as old things out, as odd things out in Sanskrit compositions, by Sanskritizing them, keeping them as close as possible in sound and in certain cases even in sense to their foreign origins. Or number three, rendering them into Sanskrit by coining their Sanskrit equivalents, keeping them fairly close then in sense and in an isolated case even in sound. In the first category, could mention words like bomb, revolver, plague, coat, tent, etc. Example, bomba sphotanani, atra plegaha utpatsyate, madana lalastam revolveras golikana balichakara, कोटादिकम अपनीय नागदंते स्थापयति, टेंटम निष्कास्य. इन द सेकंड कैटेगरी कुड बी मेंशन वर्ड्स लाइक तमसा फॉर द रिवर टेम्स इन इंग्लैंड, तमसाख्या तरंगिणी नगरम अभितः प्रवहंती दृश्यते, स्वफेन फॉर साबुन और सोप, सुगंधि स्वफेनेन स्नातव्यम्, मरुत्तर फॉर मोटर कार, भ्रमणाय चक्षुंषी चमत्कुर्वन्तो मरुत्तराः. A few more imaginative of the modern Sanskrit writers have adopted some of the foreign words with a slight phonetic change, connecting them fairly well with some Sanskrit root or the other. There is a writer who has used for the different types of the irritants, for example, Tobha for long range gun, for the gun, and which he derives from the root Tobha. Tobha Hinsayam. He says Tobha is from Tobha. Similarly, akasmadeva tobhaha chalitaha, hala for English hall, ratnakara iva vishale hale, hall being derived from the root hal, hala vilekhane, the derivation being suggested by the writer himself in halyate, vilikhyate, vidyate iti hala. In certain cases, the modern Sanskrit expressions have been Sanskritized as if they were to have been derived from the original ones. Udhama for Udhami, Punjivada for Punjavada, Punjivada. Similarly, for the undependable person, you know, who says something and has some other thing in his mind. The Hindi word is dogala, and the modern Sanskrit has used the word dogala for this. In an odd case or two, the pure Sanskrit word not much current in older literature, but current in modern vernaculars is used. For example, mali for gardener. In the third category, which incidentally has many times more the number of words than the first two, would be mentioned words like nalastra for gun, paraidhita for parasite. So we can mark, you know, how the proximity with the sound is the primary consideration for the modern Sanskrit writing writer, and partially even the sense. Or prataila for petrol. Prataila, because petrol and as in sound, it is very similar. And Taila, it is definitely, it is oil, and which is used for the mechanical vehicles. And Prataila is a percussion taila with a Prataila. So this could be interpreted like this. The common word for watch is ghati or ghatika. In English, the words for its different types. Now, the modern Sanskritist has also coined words for those different types. We have the wristwatch, we have the timepiece, we have the wall clock. Now this is what the Sanskritist has also done. For the wristwatch, we have Manibandha Ghatika. For timepiece, it is Patala Ghatika. And for wall clock, it is Bhitti Ghatika. For the word chappal, the modern Sanskritist says the word chapalopana, chapalopana udharayi. It is interesting to note that modern Sanskrit writer has given in Sanskrit words all his coinages for all the different types of bomb, which he calls Vama, connecting it fancifully with the root Vama, Vama, to Vama Udgirani in quick succession. Explosive bomb, Vishphotakah Vama. Poisonous bomb, Vishod Vamakah Vama. Incendiary bomb, Agni Vama. Time bomb, Samayapekshino Vama. When poisonous bombs, Vishod Vamakah Vama. The most irritant ones, the Vamaha, Vishphotakah Vamaha, Chapathukarino Vamaha. So does he have words for different types of gases? Narasangharanaha, Vishattaha, Ashrusravinaha, Shavinaha, Todotpadino, Visarpa Sampadinashtya Gesha, the poisonous gases, the tear gas, the nose irritant gas, the lung irritant gas, and the blister gas. The word Gesha is also an attempt on his part, a piece with the Vama to Sanskritize the foreign word by fancifully connecting it on the basis of affinity of sound, as also the contrived one of that of sense with the Sanskrit root Gesha, Gesha Anvichaya. A feature of the modern Sanskrit language that deserves a special mention is the lacking of the standard vocabulary of coinages, which varies from word to word depending upon individual perception and effort. Thus, for tea, while one word uses Kashayapana or Kashayapeya, the other uses Ushnadala, while still another prefers Chayapana or the popular words Chaya or Chaha. For railway train, while at one place a work uses the word Bashpanas, at another place it employs the word Bannivahana, while at another place it goes in for the word in Agni Ratha. Other works have other works like Gantri or Loha Shataka or Dhuma Shataka, or the feminine form of the last one, the Loha Shakati and Dhuma Shakati, or in an isolated case, just Shakati. A work, since it has to refer to a mail train, goes in for an altogether different word. Ma, पतिरागंत्री रथक और नेक्टा है वाइल वन वर्ड यूज इज द वर्ड ग्रीवा बंधन द अदर गोज इन फॉर द वर्ड कंठ बंध फॉर हैंडकरचीफ वाइल वन वर्ड हैज द वर्ड कर एंड करवासस द अदर वर्ड हैज द वर्ड करपट द डिफरेंस बीइंग रिस्ट्रिक्टेड इंटरेस्टिंगली एनफ टू द सेकंड कंपोनेंट ऑफ द वर्ड The second component of the word. The sweet meat rasgulla is designated as rasgulaka in word and rasa gulma in another. The torch is called vimarda prakashika in one word and varti in another. The pocket is called in one work as gutika and gupti in another and goha in still another. The pistol is called bhindipala in one work and pistula in another. A lock is called nalika yantra in one, loha suchi in another, vishkambhaka in still another and tala in just another. With petrol, to which the reference has already been made, one work uses prataila and the other one as bhumitaila, indicating, as it does an attempt, very ingenious indeed, of a modern writer to approximate the Sanskrit equivalent to the foreign original in both sound and sense. Now, this is about the time. I have been emphasizing time and again the various addresses that the vocabulary should be standardized. Because for now, you know, it has been a free-for-all. You know, the Sanskrit writers have used their own imagination in coining words and using them in their works, which may not sometimes be intelligible to the readers. It is therefore incumbent upon the modern scholarly fraternity to have seminars or a number of them where the scholars from different disciplines, because the Sanskrit works, you know, they pertain to not one discipline, but a plethora of them, quite a variety of them. So therefore, there will be need for the words according to the requirement of those disciplines. So therefore, the scholars drawn from different disciplines could meet in a sort of a workshop and decide upon the use of one word, you know, for an object or for an idea, as the case be. This is the need of the hour. Because otherwise, you know, over a period of time, some of the words would need a key at the end, you know, for the explanation of the words. And to some standardization that would be necessary. Now, I would switch on to the style part of it. Now, just as you know, there is a change in the vocabulary because new Sanskrit, new words have been coined, or the English words or the foreign words, they have come to be accepted as chayam vibhati, very common in the modern Sanskrit works. Even coffee pana, you can add the word pana to it, or the word paya, in chaya payam or coffee payam, itiyadi. We have the words like the coffee stuti. Now the word coffee is adopted as such. Even the word college is adopted as such. My father would call himself as Dayananda College Sanskrit Pradhyapakena Charudeva Shastrina Praditam Shri Gandhi Chaktam. So college. So we have made the word college as the basic and then use the locative singular digit, kareje. So we have we call it as the abhyutpanna nipratipadika. So these foreign words, you know, they have come to be accepted, and the vibhaktis have come to be added to them. And I may add over here a little bit, you know, it may be a good digression, that to adopt words from foreign languages is not a new phenomenon in Sanskrit. It has been going on since very, very ancient times. These words were assigned gender as well, and on the basis, certain basis, maybe sometimes very fanciful. The word, there is a Sanskrit word in Ruma. The Amarkosha explains it, Ruma shal lavana kari. The same kind of explanation is found in the Medini Kosha. Ruma shal lavana kari. Ruma is lavana kara, means the salt quarry. For the rock salt, you know, then it was quarried. So it was called Ruma. Now, Ruma is evidently, very clearly, the, I would not like to use the word, the linguist, the corrupt form, you know, it is only the changed form of, because there is there's no corruption as such. It is the evolution of the language, you can call it here, for the way of pronunciation, vocals of art. Many, many times, you know, the words undergo change in their form, in their structure, simply for the sake of the convenience, you know, of the speakers. Parampariyada pabhyancha viguneshu vidhatrishu prasiddhimagataha, as Bhartari says in the Bhartakriya. So it's been from generation to generation. People impart, you know, different form and different character to the words, you know, to suit their, you know, the convenience in pronunciation. So the word, we have the word Roma, 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 because the Indians had learned the art of quarrying salt from the Romans. The word Mlecha is Mesopotamian. Interestingly, the Dhatu Patha of Panini has the root Mlecha, and the meaning that is given there is Mlecha Abhyatri Shabda. When the foreigners came to India, the Indians couldn't understand what they were saying. So therefore, it was unclear to them as to what they were speaking. So that was the Abhyakta Shabda. And so therefore, the root Mlecha, they were called Mlecha, and the word Mlecha came to be adopted. Mlecha is not a Sanskrit word, basically it is a Mesopotamian word. And that word was adopted as such. Similarly, the word Yavana. Yavana is from the word Iona. There is a small island close to Greece. It is called Iona. Just as Sicily is close to Italy. So when the people from Iona came to India, so they were called Yavanas. Now, this Yavana was a word which was introduced into Sanskrit, which didn't exist earlier. And this became later the base word, you know, for such words as Yavanani. We have the Vartika Yavanalipyam, that in the sense of the script, you know, the word Yavanani could be used. We have Uktanukta Duruktanam Jinta Yatra Pravartate, Tam Grantham Vartikam Prahu Vartikanya Manishina. Panini didn't notice, you know, the word, you know, like Yavanani, because they are later. Yavanani, okay, must have come much later. Panini is generally assigned to the 8th century BC. And the Yavanas, you know, like Jinandara and others, you know, came later. By the time of Patanjali, they had already come. Because we say, Arunad Yavana Sagritam, Arunad Yavanu Madhyamika. So Yavana is the Meenander is referring to. So by the time, you know, of Patanjali and Varuchi, Katya and all the Yavanas had already entered into India, they had come. And so their speech, their script came to be known as Jabalani, Jabalani. So similarly, the words for coins, so we have dinar, karshapana, pana, they are all Persian words. The words, you know, for the divisions of time, like ora, is ora from Greek. There's quite a large vocabulary which Sanskrit has adopted from other languages. And this is precisely what the modern Sanskrit writers are doing. So when they get to adopt the words, you know, they use the Sanskrit case suffixes to them. Now, about the style, you know, there is a sea change. You know, some of the expressions, you know, which I have already reproduced, and it's the style of writing also. We have the first, it is the name of the speaker, occur figures, and then for the subsequent conversation, the name doesn't occur, simply it is a dash there, or it is just some dots. We have Tatra Rakeshaha Kathayati, and then the conversation starts with the Pramila. And Rakesh and Pramila occur only in the first two lines. And then. Similarly, we have, and I made a reference earlier to the various exclamatory words like go, and then the sign, just the coin, just the fanciful one on the part of the writer, is like three is used, or the sign S, successive additions to indicate the pitch. We have Gopal Bandho, Gopal Bandho, Gopal Bandho. Now here we have the pitch is rising. Somebody is calling out to Gopal Bandho. First it is 1S or 1-3, and then we have to Gopal Bandho, and or sometimes O Gopal Bandho, and then Gopal Bandho O. The O follows Gopal Bandho. So in this way it goes on, and the expressions in telephonic conversations, like just as you know, we carry on nowadays. So a telephone can be often marked by short sentences, and the answers to the queries of the party on the other hand. A few examples from some of the modern works would show as to how realistically it is represented in Sanskrit. Aham Gandhi Smaraka Chikitsalaya Bravimi Sagana Paricharya Kakshata Aham Shriman Dr. Shankaraha Sagana Paricharya Kakshayiva Vartati Sakinchita Swasthaha Sanjatosti Bhavata Swalpakalaya Ehagamyata Nahi Shriman Tadrishi Kachit Vartana Sa Baksho Vedanaya Kinchit Piditosti Aam Durabhashan Nidadhati Timbravishi Atyastos Ati Aswastosi Kutri Ranim Tvam Rugnalayam Nitosi Hang Hang Aham Gachami Aam Agachami Rugnalayam Vaidya Abhiprayam Maham Nivedaya Tvaitam Ham Aham Pratikshe Atayiva Iti Grahanim Yathasthanam Sthapayati. Grahani is the receiver. Duradhvani Dhinadah Vinayakaravah Duradhvanih Grahanim Aharaya Bhashante. Hello, Savarkara Sadhanabhidam Koyam Bhashate Shantaramah Kimbravishi Ang Taditaha Balaha Janina Kururan Taditaha Kada Ito Ninergata Matra Ahodik Kathamidanim Saha Kimbravishi Ati Aswastosti Kutre Ajanim Saha Rugnalayam Nito Vanava Aham Tat Uttaram Pratikshe Tvaritam Tvaritam Iti Grahanim Yathasthanam Sthapayati. In the dramas also, in the plays, there is the description of the entire ambience, you know, before the scene is introduced. Yatha, Prathamo Unkaha, Sthanam Mahakavehe Bhasasya Gritam. Upasthana Shala, Ekasmin Kone Natarajasya Murtihi, Vittav Chitrani, Pramukhata Evacha Saradaya Chitram. एकस्मिन् कोणे वीणा मृदंगौ अपरत्र चित्रफलकः वर्तिकाश्च सुष्ठु रचितानि हस्तलिखित पुस्तकानि एकस्मिन् स्थाने भासस्य लेखन स्थानम् पटलम् अन्या च लेखन सामग्री समग्रं वातावरणं समृद्धिं वैदग्ध्यं च द्योतयति एंड देन बिगिन्स द एक्ट सिमिलरली वी हैव राजप्रासादः न्याय सभा सम्मिलिता अस्ति एकस्मिन् पटले पुस्तक राशि श्रेष्ठ कायस्थादिकं न्यायमण्डलं स्थानापन्नं विद्यते अमात्यः देवरातः वसुमित्रः ज्ञाननिधिश्च इति एतेपि स्थानापन्नाः सन्ति तथैव केचन पौराः काचित् तत्र योषापि Living in the present age, it is not natural for the modern Sanskrit writers to come under vernacular influence. Many an expression in their works carries an unmistakable reflection of their Hindi or vernacular base. Ratravapi lokaha svapitunda dadati. People don't allow us to sleep even in the night. महाराजो दर्शन महाराज दर्शन देते उत्साह तब दृष्टिया दृष्टम जीवितम आत्मनु नेच्छामि आपकी नजर से जीवन को मैं देखना नहीं चाहता अहम पुनः तब पितरम मानयिष्यामि मैं तुम्हारे पिता को मना लूंगा अद्य खलु पश्चिमायां दिशि सूर्यः उदयति आज पश्चिम दिशा में सूर्य का उदय हुआ यस्मिन् पात्रे भोजनम तस्मिन् एव छेदनम जिस पात्र में खाना उसी में छेद करना द्विदले कालिमा परिलक्षित दाल में कुछ काला है कृपालु सिंहः भ्रष्टे या तो तब मतम भाड़ में जाए तुम्हारा विचार दत्तो लोखल शिरसाम महापुरुषाणाम नास्ते भयम भूसल जब ओखली में सिर दिया तो भूसल से क्या डरना नकोप्यत्र क्षीर क्षालिता कोई भी यहां दूध का धुला नहीं पंचांगुलयो पीते घृत एव वर्तन्ते तुम्हारे पांचों उंगलियां घी में भगवतो गृहे विलंबो वस्तु न तावत अब्रह्मण्यम भगवान के घर में देर भले ही हो अंधेर नहीं Some of the modern writers in Sanskrit furnish their works with the graphic description of places and things. They draw a veritable world picture of them. A modern writer, while describing a kitchen, refers to all that goes with it in Sanskrit words. A character Mili, now the name itself should be quite interesting, which is in the old Sanskrit. You can't expect, you know, the word Malati being called as Mili or Tuku or Tinku, Rinku, etc. But the modern Sanskrit words have such words now. That is the modern Sanskrit. So Mili in the words and in the work in the novel Anjali, you know. And the kitchen. So she looks around and notices all that goes with it in a state of disarray. She arranges all the things. The writer has Sanskrit words for the kitchen items, some of which are his coinages. It would have been better if he would have given their equivalents in Hindi or English or vernaculars to enable the reader to make out as to what he means by them. Nili shakam pakashalam parabhishat sarvato drishtim nikshiptavati itaha kathoram pitharam ghataha dolam tatascha pachani galani sthali sthalika tapa tatra darvi chamasi sandanshi anyatra belanam pitha churi nalam kakalam evam sarvam kinchit itastato vikshiptam sa sajji kritapati. In contrast to this, the writer of these lines, you know, myself, while mentioning the improvised bazaar at Tübingen, Germany, you know, that is, since the experience pertains to me, so I will may not have to refer to the text which is before me. So, when I was about to depart for Germany, so one of my colleagues at the university came to me and said that, sir, you are a vegetarian, and so therefore you will have to prepare your food for yourself. And now that may not be so easy for you, but you may not be used to it. So therefore you go to an department store, and there are packed tins of vegetables, cut their lid, pour the contents into a pan, and the heat, and have with bread. No, I never followed the advice because I prefer to cook myself, the same party that I am. So now, what I found in Tübingen was that every Wednesdays and Fridays, there would be a bazaar in the city where the farmers would bring their produce from their farms, the very fresh, the farm fresh. And then they had their cheese, you know, the different varieties, and the milk also, with certain fruits and in them. And similarly, we had the yogurt, so we have the pineapple yogurt or the apple yogurt, other kinds of fruits, you know, with the various berries, the strawberry yogurt. And so. So what I would do would be that I would leave my apartment, and then I had to pass through that bazaar. The route was such to reach the institute. So I would pick up some items which I would need, some vegetables, something of cheese and milk, etc. And I would, when I reached the institute, there was a special cupboard, you know, so meant for me. I would just put all these things there. In the afternoon, late afternoon, when I would leave the institute back for home, so I would collect all these things, go back to my apartment, and then devote an hour or so, you know, to cook my food myself. So now, what I found in the bazaar on display, the farmers, you know, they would put up some temporary tents to serve as their sales outlet. And they would come there early in the morning, by 7 o'clock, and then by 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, so they will remove these stalls, and then everything, you know, would come back to normal. There was, as if, you know, there was no activity, but when this bazaar was on, you know, people will throng that, you know. And so that was surprising, that, you know, even though all these things were available in the departmental stores and others, so they would prefer to have these fresh things rather than going for the packed ones. Now, this in my First of all, you have my autobiography. I have described my stay in Tübingen and my passing through that bazaar. A little bit of description of that bazaar, the things available over there in the form of the vegetable and other stuff. So I have given. Yeah. Now I will read out just a few lines from there. Tübingen nagare anya yuropiya nagaravan madhye nagaram अति विशाले चत्वरे प्रतिबुधवासरं प्रतिशुक्रवासरं च हट्टः स्थापितो भवति अपराह्नं यत्र कृषकाः नानाविधान् शाकान् फलानि पयो दधि केवलं वा फलादि मिश्रितं वा आमिक्षाश्च विविधाः वृद्धश्च कठिनाश्च सद्यः साधिताश्च बहुकालपूर्वं साधिताश्च व्यञ्जनमिश्राश्च अव्यञ्जनमिश्राश्च विक्रयार्थं प्रस्तुवन्ति जनास्तद्धत्तां अहमहमिकया आपतन्ति शस्ते तत्र स्यूतहस्ताः गतागतं कुर्वाणाः दिल्लिवतं प्रयान्ति शाकादय तत्र तस्मिन्नेव महति प्रत्यूषे ततः पूर्वदिनेभ्यः पूर्वदिने वा क्षेत्रेभ्यः सञ्चिता भवन्ति न तु आपण सञ्चयवत् नानादिनपूर्वं सञ्चिता इति तत्क्रयणे जनानां भवति विशेषाग्रहः भारतीयविद्यासंस्थानार्थं पन्थाश्चत्वरत एव आसीत् अहं हट्टात् शाकान् तत्र सर्वविधाः शाकाः सर्षपशाकः पालकशाकः मूलकं गृञ्जनं वृन्ताकः कर्कटी अलागुः तुम्बी कूष्माण्डं पुष्पजिह्वा कपिशाकः पत्रकोजिह्वा ग्रन्थिकोजिह्वा कलायाः आलुकं पलाण्डुः रागालुः इत्यादि सर्वं क्रीत्वा संस्थाने मदर्थं निर्धारिते कबर्ड इत्यत्र अहम् न्यास्थम्। Now these are the different words. So some of these I have called, you know, like tomato. Tomato we have ragalu. So and some of the modern writers have used these, but some of the names occur in our old texts, in the Vanaushadhi Varga, our portions also. So they may not be able, may not be using these words now, but they do occur. Now, you know, I will conclude. It's more than an hour. It is this innovative spirit of the modern Sanskrit writers that has given a form and a character to modern Sanskrit literature, which differentiates it from its older counterpart. It is a queer admixture of modernity and antiquity, while keeping themselves within the framework of Panini. Sometimes that may also not be the case. The modern Sanskrit writers are introducing new words and new styles in their writings. Now, before I conclude, I would like to say a word over here in context of a new style. There is something which is called the genius of speech. That has to be adhered to, and sometimes that is not observed by modern Sanskrit writers. There is no indirect speech in Sanskrit, while it has become common enough a phenomenon in modern Sanskrit works. Sa kathayate sa gramam kamishyate. This doesn't agree with this genius of Sanskrit. Tena idam chintitam yat tena tatra gantavyam eva. Tena idam chintitam yan mayana tatra gantavyam. That is the direct speech. Indirect speech is foreign to the genus of speech. Similarly, the word Sanskrit, which is used in the family, this is a debatable point. I have given considerable thought to it, whether it should be used in the family, can it be used? Ajar Gandhiya said, Sanskritam na daivi vak. Sanskritam vak. Sanskrita is a niyatalinga shabda. And we have words in which have their fixed gender. And some, they don't have the fixed gender. They can have more than one gender. So, we have vana and vipina. This is the fixed gender. It has to be neutral. But Amra can have the masculine gender and the neuter gender with different sense. The Amra means if the sense is that of the tree, the word Amra is to have the masculine gender. Amra shasikta pitarashta pindita. But when the sense is that of the fruit, it has to be the neuter gender. The word Harmya, Harmyosri, Dhaninam Vasa, this is from the other portion. The Harmya is Astri, is not to be used in feminine gender, but it can have both the masculine and as well as the neuter gender. Now, which is the style of Amar Singh, the compiler of the other portion, that the sense in which he thinks that the word is more in use. He would use it in that gender. Harmyaha astri. Now, say harmyaha. Now, it means harmya in the masculine gender is more prominent than the gender. So, there are words so which occur in different genders. But Sanskrita is that word which has to be used or should be used in neuter gender only. Now, but there is some not finality about it, because the Ramayana creates a problem over here. And when Hanuman goes to the Ashoka Vatika, and then he is assailed with doubt as to in which language is he to speak to Sita. And there the famous verse occurs, and he says, Yadivacham Pradasyami Vyatiri Sanskritam Ravanam Manyamanam Sita Gita Vishati. Now, if he were to speak in Sanskritam Vacham, Yadi Sanskritam Vacham Pradasyami, Tada Ravanam Manyamanam Sita will mistake him for Ravana, because they are Maya rupees. And maybe Ravana has assumed the form of Maitri and as is approaching her. And so therefore, Sita, Bhita, she will get scared. So, and will not be forthcoming. So that is the now Sanskritam Vacham Pradyasyami. Now the Sanskritam that has been interpreted differently by different commentators. Some say Sanskritam means the Parishkritam, or the Sanskritam Vacham speech, you know, which was current in the northern part of India, the Kosala Desha Samipavarti Chetre Pratalita Vat, it is Sanskrita Vat. And so, therefore, that is how the word Sanskrita is explained by some of the commentators. But, you know, coming to Acharya Dandin, by that time the Sanskrit had come to heaven. Even if in the time of the Ramayana the word Sanskrit could have been used, as some of the commentators have explained it, could be used in the feminine Sanskritam Vacham on that basis. By the time of Acharya, the word Sanskrit had come to have a fixed gender, and this Sanskritam Vacham, Sanskritam Nama Daivi Vacham. So it is the divine speech, Sanskritam Vacham, Sanskritam neuter, Vacham feminine, and both of them going together. So, but about the indirect speech, of course, you know, so I am myself not very comfortable with its appearance in the modern Sanskrit literature. So, that these are some of the points which I have mentioned over here, because there are many things to say in the context of the modern Sanskrit, from the, because as I said, it's fast growing. There are works in which are appearing in it, and in the number or in the volume, the modern Sanskrit literature compares very favorably than any Indian language. So that would be the vastness of it. And there is time, you know, we have proper analysis of it, proper appreciation of it, the vast treasure, you know, that is coming up. And so it has developed a character. So it describes the most modern of the things. The people working in the hospitals, the nurses moving about with their, and the doctors with the stethoscopes, and the clinics, you know, for the various medical tests and the checkups and the instruments. So, and the modern Sanskritist has to describe them if he is living in the modern period. So it was then the Sanskritist to be true to his work in the age, due to the age in which he is living. He has to describe it. And so therefore, if he is living in a modern age, why can't he describe the modern things? And if we describe the modern things, so the vocabulary and the style have also to conform to it. And that is what makes the Sanskrit as the modern Sanskrit. And it's in totality, in its appearance, is different from the old Sanskrit. And to that extent, you know, there is a line which can be drawn between the two types of Sanskrit, the old Sanskrit and the modern Sanskrit. The stylistic and the structural analysis would be all these papers. I'm very happy that I was able to share some of my views. Did you, on the basis of my study of a big corpus of Sanskrit work, and I'm in the habit of whichever work comes to my notice, which are brought my notice, so that's my weakness. I go to it cover to cover, and I take notes of whatever, you know, the modern writers have done, their attempts, and this is I appreciate the growth of them. I call it as the evolution, and I don't decry it. I don't even underrate it. If it is a living expression, then it has to have to the vibrance in it. It has to throb, you know, and it has to be the carrier of the spirit, you know, of something which is current and not something which belongs to the old. It is in this format, you know, it could be, but in the vocabulary, the themes, and the style, it is modern. And it is therefore a very, very queer phenomenon. Very few languages, probably it is the only language in the world, you know, which is growing, which is evolving, which is developing. Greek, Latin, Egyptian, and the other languages, you know, so they have no evolution of them. They are learned, but the Sanskrit has it. So therefore, Sanskrit is a living idiom, is very much alive now, as it had been alive centuries past, when it was just called Bhasha. the words Sanskrit, you know, for this Sanskrit came in use much later. Even in the time of Yaska or the time of Panini, it was just called Bhasha. Bhashayam sadavsa shiva sakrishi shviti bhashayam. Similarly, in Yaska and Nirutta, iviti bhashayam. Uvaimannodhaya, to distinguish it from the Vedic speech. So the classical Sanskrit speech was the Bhasha. And the name Sanskrit came in use for it later. And so since then, it had been in existence. And Yavad Ganga Chagodache, Tavadeva Hi Sanskritam. Sanskrit will continue till flow the rivers Ganga and Goda. But thanks to all of you for giving me patient hearing. Thank you all. Thank you, my friend.